Welcome back. In my last video about things nobody talks about in 3D printing, I listed 20 things. And then immediately afterwards, I realized there's a lot more. So I thought, let's make a video about them. So today, not as many as last time, but I have 10 more things nobody talks about when it comes to 3D printing. And they're 10 things that you should know if you're looking to get a 3D printer. And if you have one, you probably already know, but if not, hopefully this helps. To make things a little bit easier, and because I'm getting how YouTube works a little better now, I'm going to try and portion these off, and I'm going to list up in the corner what printer they apply for. Last time I got a little flack for, well, this is all for resin printers, and I'm going to try and do it pretty equal today. A lot of these things go for both printers, so anyone looking to get a printer, this applies to you. Number one, on a resin printer, don't print things flat. And I know that sounds confusing, but when you have a object that you're printing, especially a large object, and you're putting it on a resin printer, if it has a flat bottom on it and you're printing it, you think to yourself, oh, it's got this nice solid base. It's got this nice solid flat part and it'll print better because of that. No. One of my good friends who bought a resin printer struggled a lot because he was trying to put everything flat. He was trying to get that nice solid connection to the build plate. But the problem with that is like I've said before, when you're printing with resin, it's playing tug of war with your build plate, which is on the top, and the FEP sheet, which is below. Okay, and so basically they come together, light shines, makes a solid object, and then the build plate pulls it off, but it sticks to both of them. And so if you have this giant flat surface, it's like playing tug of war with a truck and you got to pull that truck off. And so prints fail and they fail a lot because of that. So just kind of keep that in mind when you're printing with resin, it's a lot better to, instead of have something flat, have it angled just a bit. Yeah, it's going to have supports to do that. But then instead of tug of war with a truck, it's more like tug of war with a small child because it's just this little piece and it makes it a lot easier. So don't print flat if you can help it. Number two, when printing, and I put this specifically as FDM, an FDM printer, when you're printing something, usually you're printing something large on an FDM printer. I mean, that's generally why you buy it, is so you can print bigger stuff. Anything small you can do on your resin printer, right? Sure, you can still print small things on your FDM, but just kind of for the sake of this, if you're printing something large, orient it so that you don't have to use a ton of supports. Same friend that I was just talking about printed a helmet, and he printed it top down, and so it filled the inside of the helmet with supports. Whereas if he had printed it upside down, yeah, it would have had some supports across the top of the helmet, but the inside would have been clean and free of supports. He would have used a fifth of the supports that he did printing it the other way. So orient your print in a way that you don't need a ton of supports. And with that being said, maybe this is like 2.5, you can change the overhang that supports are printed on. Your printer can easily print at a 45 degree angle. And I should know, I have a starting printer. It's, you know, it's a great printer, but it's the starting one. It doesn't have any upgrades or anything on it, and it prints at 45 degree angles, no problem. It does it all day, every day. So your printer can do it. So get rid of supports if you can. Now, sometimes you want supports. You want that thing to be sturdy, especially if you're printing a helmet. If you're printing it upside down, you don't want it to have just one tiny little point of contact, because if anything hits it, it's gonna knock it over. So just look at the supports, look at what you're willing to do. If you want to use all those supports, it's your filament. Do whatever you want. I'm just saying, you can save a lot of filament just by changing how you orient stuff in your slicer. Okay, number three is for both types of printers. And that's simply that orientation affects the strength. And what I mean by that is this is a printer. Both printers print in layers. Okay, so there's thousands of layers, boop, 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 boop. And just like with this. This was printed top down like this because I didn't want to do a ton of supports. I mean, this was supportless. It didn't need supports to print, but you got to keep in mind that because the lines are going this way, this piece is more likely to break. Now, I don't want to break it. It's pretty strong as it is, but it's more likely to break if I had printed it this way than I would have had the back and forth lines. And then it would have been way more sturdy that way. So pay attention to how you orientate stuff. How you orientate? How you orient? Whatever.
I'm not a smart man.
How you put stuff on the build plate. And especially with the resin printers, if you're printing little minis and you're printing a miniature with a bow or with a sword or something like that, that sword is going to be brittle if you print it straight up and down. I just printed a spear, right? This whole thing. These, I printed them standing up because I wanted to save resin. I didn't want to fill in the inside and tear them all out. But I have to live with the fact that they are much more brittle because they were printed up and down. So keep that in mind as you're printing something. That orientation directly affects the strength of something. Granted, in resin, it's not so much just because the layers are so small, but it still has an effect. If you want your swords and things to be strong, or staffs, or whatever it is you're printing, keep that in mind when you put it on the build plate. And yeah, I 3D printed a spear. It's freaking awesome. 3D printers are great. Number four. One of the big beefs with FDM printing is that you have all of these layer lines and everything like that. You're going to have them. If you're printing something big, you sand them down, you do whatever you need to. You can do it on something small with a lot of stuff. Okay, but there is a setting inside of your slicer for FDM that's called ironing. Ironing's kind of cool. What it does is it prints that top layer, and then it heats up the nozzle, and it goes right back over the top, and it kind of irons everything down and flattens it down. You can't use it for a lot of things, but you can use it for some things. So get out there, try it. It's pretty cool. I made a coaster. And granted, it's not perfect, but if I wanted it to be perfect, it would take 10 seconds of sanding versus 10 minutes. So kind of a cool thing. Get out there, give it a try. Number five, this one applies to FDM printers. The build plate heats up. Okay, and it heats up so that stuff sticks to it better, so it works better. Okay. Don't be so eager to get your print off that you pull it off when the build plate is hot. This is my first build plate. And granted, it's very dirty and everything else. It hasn't been used in a year. But if you look at the center, here, if I turn around, you can probably see it a little better. The center right here, that's where the top came off because I was pulling stuff off of it. You pull those prints off of it when it's hot and they will start to pull away the texture. The textured surface of this. So keep that in mind, okay? Another thing I wanted to add, textured surfaces, sometimes they can be helpful. Take advantage of the bed. Well, the build plate, the bed, yeah, sorry, bad joke. Take advantage of that. If you have a glass one, anything you print on there will be nice and solid and flat. Like it almost has a mirror sheen if you get that nozzle close enough. If you want to build bases that look like the bases that come with like Warhammer miniatures that kind of have that raised texture to them, most build plates come with that. So print them face down, and then when you pop it off, guess what? It comes with that. So just kind of keep that in mind when printing stuff. The build plate surface can help you. Okay, this one applies to both. Buy in bulk. And what I don't mean like parts, I don't mean printers, obviously, but resin or the FDM, whatever you buy, buy multiples of it. And the reason I say that is because, yeah, you can print with every different color, every different brand, whatever you want, but you're going to have to adjust things depending on what you buy. So your one resin might print great, and then you move on to a different color and it doesn't print as great because you have to adjust things. Same with the FDM. You got to do a different heat. You got to do a different... everything. Okay, there's different stuff. So if you want to print a lot and you want to print fast, buy the same stuff. Okay, I'm not telling you to go out and buy 10 spools of thread. I did, because I got them for 10 bucks a piece. And I used them all. And it was the fastest printing I ever did because I didn't have to change any settings. It was awesome. So just kind of buy in bulk when you can. You'll thank me later. This is another one that applies to both. Don't be afraid to cut your files. It's super easy. You use the simple Microsoft 3D tool to open it up and you cut it. It's quick, it's easy, and you save it. You cut a piece off, you save that piece, you go back to the rest, you cut another piece off. Are you always gonna have to do that? No, most of the time you're not. But if you wanna print something and you want it to stay a certain size and it's too big for your printer, your only option is to cut it into pieces and print those pieces. And like I said, that applies to resin as well as FDM, but it's not hard. I have a video that goes over it and I'll put it up in up here or here. One of them, I don't know which one. And you can go in and you can see how it's done. And like I said, it's easy. Don't worry, don't be afraid of trying it. Anybody can do it. Okay, this one is specifically for resin and it's been one that has been on my mind a ton lately because I've started printing some bigger objects. Do everything in your power to cure the inside of an object. If you print it hollow, which you should if you want to save resin, the inside of that needs to be cured as well. You can do that by putting a hole in it and then shining a light inside, or you know, you can get little LEDs that you can put inside that are UV LEDs. There's different ways to do it, but just do your best to cure the inside. I keep hearing these horror stories of prints that people have and they've had for years and then they go pick it up off the shelf and it's like starting to melt because the resin inside was never cured. So do what you can to cure the inside of something. If it's too small to get anything in, you might be better off just printing it solid. That's my thought process. So just kind of keep that in mind. If you print something big, put a hole in it somewhere where you can put a light in and cure the inside of it. It'll make it stronger. And 10 years from now, when you're still enjoying it, you'll be grateful you did. The next one also goes to resin. And I thought about it the entire time I was printing my Warhound proxy back there. Don't be afraid to mix resin. That started out bright orange, then I was getting low on resin, and so I started pouring in gray, and so it became this ugly dull orange, and slowly gray. I was super nervous that, you know, you get down to the end of a color, and it's just like, well, I can't print anything because I don't have enough resin, and you end up throwing some resin away. Don't. Pour in whatever resin you have, mix it together, make some ugly finger painting colors like you did when you were a kid. It'll still print. Might not look as pretty, but that's why we prime things, right? So just prime it, it'll look great. Don't worry about it. Finally, number 10. This one applies to people who do and don't have printers. Get a big list of stuff that you want to print. Because a printer with nothing to print is just a giant waste of space. You know, and a lot of people think, oh, I want a 3D printer because I want to print this and I want to print this. Think about what you're gonna want to print a year from now. I have a hobby that makes it awesome. D&D stuff, I print nonstop. Warhammer stuff, I've started printing. Terrain stuff, I've got all sorts of stuff. I mean, look at me. I literally printed a spear. I have a gun. I have a spaceship. I have a helmet. I've got all sorts of crap. And yes, my wife asks me every time I print something, well, what are you gonna do with that? Most of the time I don't have an answer, but it's fun. So make sure you have stuff that you want to print. I talk to people all the time that, oh, I have a 3D printer. I haven't printed anything in years. Well, why not? I just kind of ran out of stuff I wanted to print. If you don't have a printer, start making your list if you want to buy one. If you do have a printer, get another hobby. 3D printing doesn't have to be your only hobby. You can start printing for something else. And D&D with miniatures on the table is awesome. And if you're curious what you can be printing, I got another video right here. Talks about this first things that a DM should print. Go ahead and check it out. And if you like the content that we're putting out there, please like and subscribe. We're getting close to 500 subscribers, and I would love to get to that point where I can start, you know, selling shirts and things. I got some awesome ideas. I think you'll like them. So like, subscribe, join the channel, help us grow, and we'll keep putting content out there. And if you've got something that you learned as a 3D printer that you want to share, put it in the comments. I would love to hear it. If you didn't see our first video of the 20 things nobody talks about, I have it linked down below. You can go and check that out as well. thank you for spending some time with us at Pulsegate Games. And as always, don't spend so much time creating your world that you forget to spend some time in it. Until next time.